So lots of times when we talk about vectors, we talk about just free vectors. They could start anywhere, end anywhere. So if we had the vector 2 comma 3, that means you're going 2 units to the right, 3 units up. That would be the vector 2 comma 3. And it could be anywhere, and you could slide it anywhere. Now, when we get to a position vector, we're giving it a specific spot, sort of like a coordinate on the coordinate plane. And a position vector always starts from a fixed point, which we usually use the origin, and goes to another point. So if this was a position vector, then this would be, say, that's starting at the origin, and it's ending at the point P, which is at 2 comma 3. And now it's not just roaming anywhere. So anytime you have a point, you can make every single point a position vector. And then if you want to find the vector between two points, you can use the position vectors to find it. So I've got the point M right here, and it's going to point N right there. And I have the vector MN. Now, since a vector is considered the same no matter how you get there, just like we saw in the cartoon, you could also get from M to N by first going to O, and then going from O and going back to N. And so we would write that if I wanted to get from M to N, that's the same as starting at M and going to O, and then going from O, oops, to N. Moon. And according to this diagram, if I go from M to O, that would be negative M, and O to N would be N. And so you'll see a lot of textbooks write that if you want to go from M to N, you can do that by going N minus M. I personally much, much prefer writing minus M plus N. Because if the position vector is always from O to M, and it's given here in this diagram, so I would have to go the opposite to get back to O. Well, since we're talking about position vectors, a position vector always starts at O and goes to a point. So the reason I like writing minus M plus N is you can always draw a diagram and say, I'm starting here. Not very many people say, oh, I want to start here, so first I will go this way. And then I will go minus N. This is what N and minus M look like if you do them in this order. It ends in the same spot, but it's not as intuitive as saying, oh, I'm going to go back to the origin first and then go to my next point. And if you use intuition this way in vectors, they become very easy to work with. I find if you try to just use formulas, then you're going to get confused with what you're actually doing. If you wanted to go from N to M, does it make sense you could first go to O? Don't say no. And then go from O to M. Noom. Would be good. So we want to find this vector here in green, O to P. And we know that M to P is halfway from M to N. So if I want to go from O to P, can you see that I can first go from O to M and then go halfway from M to N? And since I already know that O to M was the vector M, and we already figured out that M to N was negative M plus N, I can put this together. M plus negative half M will be half of M plus half of N. They would like you to develop it. So usually when you simplify it, take the brackets off. Now, if we think about what this means, okay, here's O to M, okay, halfway. Would go to there. Half of M would go to there. Here is O to N, and half of that would go to there. Now, if I added half M plus half N, that means I start at the yellow, add this one on top of it, and it matches up perfectly to go from O to P. Very nice. The diagram, even drawn not well to scale, works beautifully with vectors. What this is going to allow you to do mathematically is figure out all sorts of complicated, you don't like geometry questions. It will simplify them like crazy. So you've got points A, B, and C, and you have position vectors for them, A, B, and C. P is the midpoint of A, B. Q is the midpoint of B and C. So how could you write the position vector? You want to go from O to P. How could you get there? Does it make sense that if you started at O, you could go O to A, and then go halfway from A to B? Okay. Well, O to A we can write as the position vector A, because that was given to us. But A to B, how do you go from A to B using only A, Bs, and Cs? Well, I could go first back to O, and then from O to B. Well, here though, vector AB would be starting at A. I could go back to the origin, that would be negative A, and add B. And if I have half of that, that would go halfway, halfway, and get me from A to P. Maybe, wow, would it feel better? Wow, let's try. Here, we'll do this. Just want to move this down just a bit Does this look better? Does this help if I add that extra sentence in there? If I want to go from O to P, I can go from O to A and then A to P. And then instead of A to P, I could say, well, I know that's the midpoint, so A to P is half of A to B. O to A is matrix A. A to B would be first going back to the origin and then going to B. Simplifying this, we get 1 half of A plus 1 half of B. If you make a midpoint between anywhere, yes. So here you could do half B plus half C to get to Q, is what you're asking, if you can use that as a shortcut. Like if I want to find from O to Q, it's going to be from O to B plus from B to Q, and halfway from B to C, and then O to B is B, and B to C would be going back and then adding C, so you would get half B plus half C. Now write PQ in terms of A, Bs, and Cs. So now we're trying to figure out what is this vector from here to here. So if I want to go from P to Q, to Q, I could go from P back to O and then go from O to Q. And since we already figured out O to P, does it make sense that P to O would be a negative 1 half A plus 1 half B? And O to Q we already have as 1 half B plus 1 half C. Okay, simplifying this, can you see the 1 half B's will cancel out? And we'll have negative 1 half A plus 1 half C. Now, how does vectors make what would have been a doable but annoying math question in geometry much easier? Let's give these points. Okay? Let's say that's the origin. Would you agree that this, we could make this at 10, 0? This one looks like it's at 9, 4, maybe. And then estimating this one to be at 6, 8. Okay? Those are the points A, B, and C. P is the midpoint of A, B. Q is the midpoint between B and C. What is the distance between P and Q? Think about the math that you would have done in the past. No, we haven't, but that's the question we're going to now solve, and we're going to help, but use our vectors to help us. Okay? So, I put coordinates on there just to say, you could, using your old mathematics, What could you do? You could find the midpoint and label P. You could find the midpoint and label Q, and then use your distance formula between P and Q to find the actual distance. That would be using mathematics of grade 9 and grade 10. And it's doable, and it's not super hard. But now that we know what vectors do, we just created a vector equation for PQ. PQ was negative one half A, so using the numbers, negative one half, what was A? A would be the vector 6, 8, plus 1 half, and what was C? 10, 0. Putting these together, we have negative 3 plus 5, 2, and negative 4 plus 0, negative 4. Does it make sense that P to Q goes 2 to the right and 4 down? Looks like it could work. And then the length of P to Q, A squared plus B squared, square root of 20. So our vectors let us do that. What makes it even more powerful is if these were three-dimensional vectors, the midpoints would be much more annoying to figure out using analytic geometry. But with vectors, it would be just as simple. Which is kind of exciting. Well, it was regular at one time, and then it went irregular. So now our origin is right at the center of our regular hexagon, A, B, C, D, E, F. If OA is A and AB is given to be B, find O to B. Okay? Can you see quite easily from the diagram that if you wanted to go from O to B, all you'd have to do is go A plus B, and you would get there. Technically, if you wanted to, you could do A plus minus A plus A plus minus A plus A plus B. That would still get you at the same spot, and vectors don't care how long it takes to get there, as long as you have a starting point and an ending point with what you want. If you wanted to get from B to D, I want to start here. I want to end here. Can you see that I could get there this way, this way, this way? How would I write that? Right, you could also go here, but then we don't have anything. So from B to D, if I do the way that I've drawn it there, I could go negative B plus a negative A plus another negative A. In other words, negative B minus two A's. How would you go from C to F? Can you see that C to O is the same as B to A? Oh, it's a regular hexagon. You don't do that in China. Here, regular hexagon. If you split it up, you can easily see that it makes six triangles that are perfectly equal to each other. Your hexagon is not regular. It got stretched a little bit. So they'd all be 60 degrees, and they'd all be equilateral triangles, and they'd all parallel to each other. So if I wanted to go from C to F, that would be the same as going negative two B's. If you wanted to actually have a pathway for it, you could go this way, which would be a negative A, and then this way, which would be a negative B, then this way, which would be a negative A, then this way, which would be another negative B. That's a positive A. And then the A's would cancel out, and you would still get negative 2B. And that's the power of vectors, is that you can call something a negative B if it matches up with a parallel, because two vectors are equal if they're the same length and the same direction. The starting point and ending point doesn't have to be equal. Why is it all stopping? There we go. So OABC is a parallelogram. OA is vector A, OB is vector B. And the point P lies on AB such that AB to BP is 2 to 1. Do you know how to read those ratios? Whatever length this is, AB, B to P is half of that. So if this were 6, this length would be 3. Does that make sense? The point Q lies on CB such that CQ to QB is 3 to 1, or 1 to 3. So that means if this length is 1, this length is 3. Does it make sense that going from C to Q would be going 1/4 of C to B? Wow, my half arrow's looking bad. And sometimes I find that that ratio part is an area where someone makes a mistake, because they're like, but the ratio says 1 to 3. How did you get that 1/4 of the way? Well, if you think of it in values like this, same thing with this one. Does it make sense that A to B is equal to 2/3 of A to P, based on this ratio of 2 to 1. Because the whole length would be 3, and you've gone 2/3 of it when you go there. So that understanding of ratios, and I do find that if you label some values on there just temporarily, you can get those ratios. You can't leave these values, because what does this assume? This assumes that this length and this length are the same, and they may not be. But for the proportions, this can work. So now that I've got my proportions and ideas that way, we want to express each of these ideas in terms of A and B. So if I want to start at A and go to B, can you see that I could first go from A to O and then from O to B? If that's the case, A to O will be negative A, and O to B is B, so I get negative A plus B. If I want to go from to A to P, can you see that A to P is what fraction of A to B? It's going to be more than one. Three twos, I love it. Three twos of A to B. I think there's a reason we don't say tooths. Do you think they used to say tooths? And that's why they refer to the plural of as teeth, to not confuse it with tooths? Perhaps. And then they just decided that halves was better? Maybe. This is, well, history of the English language wondered. So now we know that A to B was negative A plus B. So A to P will equal negative 3/2 A plus 3/2 B. Check it out. There is a half A. And there's a half B. If I put the arrowhead on the other side here, this would be a negative A, and this would be a negative half A, and that would be a positive half B. Apparently, going from A to P, I can take 1/2, 2/2, 3/2, and then one of these, two of these. My scales, I didn't quite get them in the right measurements. It was going to be like a huge, oh, I see it moment. Perfect. It worked out. And now you were like, the light bulbs went off in your heads and you're like completely amazed by this instead of disappointed. Oh, well. Back to reality. Now, if we wanted to go from O to P, how could we do that? Can you see that it's easy to go from O to A and then A to P? And since we've already figured out what A to P is, O to P, go from O to A and then A to P. O to A is A, and A to P was negative 3/2 A plus 3/2 B. Simplifying this, negative 1/2 A plus 3/2 B. Which one is off? Which one did I draw bad? Was this one not a half a B? Is it not quite halfway? Oh, this one was short. Look at that. this one needs to be a little bit longer. This one, was it? Well, that one was way too long. I should have actually measured it in half, and it would have probably worked out really nicely. Okay, no. No, it's good. No, even diagrams, vectors are, like, even not to scale, but it should work. Here we go. We have to do this. Okay, that's 20, so 10 would be the middle. Obviously, this is really easy to measure this way. The middle is right there. So this is a better half A. So, oh, look at how much better that is. Okay? And measuring this one. Right there. That is a better. Not this one. This one we have to uninfinite clone it and delete it. And it's the red one. Well, we only need one of those. So according to this, negative A. So we start from here, negative A. Plus, we need three of these.
Oh, wow. What? No way. Oh, my goodness.
There's something enjoyable about that. And that it works out so nicely. And it's not intuitive when you draw it out, like, oh, this is the path I want to take. Much easier to see going along the pathways that are drawn. But it works out perfectly. And then O to Q, we can go O to C, and then I'm going O to C. Oh, yeah, O to B. Yeah, we don't have. Yes, we have to go O to B. So O to Q. We'll go from O to B, because we have that. And then go 3/4 from B to C. To Q. But no, BC. Sorry, I'm going to write that as B to Q first. That makes sense, O to B and then B to Q. And O to B, that one we already know is B. And B to Q is 3/4 of B to C. And B to C, since it's a parallelogram, is just negative A. Hence, this again is taken from an IB curriculum question, and hence the word hence. And the way that they use the word hence to replace using the results that you got in the previous question, show that QP is equal to half of A plus half of B. It's like a therefore, but it's like hence using what you just found. Mm-hmm. So QP would be QO plus OP. Oh, this, I mean, coop. And it sounds like something, and then it made me think of, like, you want inappropriate vector jokes, right? How can you write PP? Okay. That would be true. Yes. I should erase that. So, in vectors, PP is equal to poop. Now, Q to O is just negative O to Q. And O to P, negative 1/2 plus 3/2 B. And from this, what are we going to have? Putting things together, we'll end up with 1/2 B and 3/4 plus 1/4 A. Whoa. It is a real word. Oh. Collinear means things all end up on the same line. So you've got A, which I'm going to write as a column vector. Who said colon? Collinear. No, we're not talking about colons. We've gone away from those jokes. Okay. That's fine. Well, we can go if, does it, how would we prove that three things are in a straight line, okay? Okay, one way that you could show that they're in the straight line is if you show that the direction from A to B is the same as the direction from B to C, they would have to be in a straight line. Does that make sense? If you were thinking on a coordinate plane, that would be like saying the slope is the same. If the slope from A to B were the same as the slope from B to C, since they share the point B, they would have to be in a straight line. Okay? Now, we're dealing in three dimensions. We don't really have the same definition of slope in three dimensions, but we could say if two vectors are parallel, okay, if AB and BC are parallel, does that logic work for you? I don't know. It is, but it's one of those times where you write something and you look at it and start to feel like you didn't write it. That makes sense. The other thing you could do is you could figure out the distance from A to B, the distance from B to C, and the distance from A to C. And if A to B plus B to C is equal to A to C, that would also work. But it would take more calculations than what we're about to do.
A to B plus B to C is A to C?
Yes. Does that make sense? If I travel 3 and then I travel 4, the distance that I traveled in a straight line is 7. But if I decided to travel 3 this way and 4 this way, well, now the distance between them, not in a straight line, is less. So first of all, how do we find A to B? A to B, well, we could go back to the origin, which would be negative A, and add B above this. I'm going to write A to O plus O to B. And I could figure out B to C by going back to the origin . This would be negative O to B, and then, well, technically this is B to O, I like that. B to O plus O to C. So we have that AB is equal to 1, 3, negative 2. And we have that B to C is equal to 3, 9, negative 6. Now, we've got those. How do we say those are parallel? Right? Yes. So if one of them is a scalar multiple of the other, then they're parallel. So in other words, could we write BC to equal K times by AB? If there's a K value that works, then we know that they're parallel. And you can see that if I write it out, BC was 3, 9, negative 6, and this one was 1, 3, negative 2. And so because we were asked to show something, This means that A, B, and C are collinear. And this question had too many words with double L's. A, B, and C are on the same line. Like we, in English, we have the word co in front of something to sort of mean that it coexists, works together. Exactly the same line. Corn. So bad. I can scroll up, yes. Coke. Even more. That one is actually one that is things together. Code. All right, we've got one more example to do before the homework, but I'll give you the questions already. Co-nut. That's a double one. We probably should have stopped recording a long time ago.